copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Oakland police calling all cars, attention all cars. Wanted for murder. A man described as follows. Medium build, has black hair, blue eyes.
Drive your car approximately 10,000 miles during 1937.
Police cars of Los Angeles will each travel 80,000 miles during 1937.
Any kind of gasoline will get you over 10,000 miles if you buy enough of it, but
any kind of gasoline will not give you the remarkable performance police cars get. Rio Grande Crack is the gasoline of police car performance. Los Angeles police cars have used it exclusively year after year.
This is likewise true of Oakland, Berkeley, Fresno, Santa Barbara, San Diego, Orange County, San Diego County, Maricopa County, Arizona, and many, many other cities and towns.
Yes, more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment use Rio Grande Crack gasoline wherever it is sold than any other brand. This is because it is cracked into tiny atoms by the famous patented Sinclair cracking process. These broken up atoms burn more readily and more completely. You get quicker starting and greater power, just as police cars do. And you need less Rio Grande cracked gasoline to travel 10,000 miles. Don't be satisfied during 1937 with slow-burning, sluggish gasoline. Make it a year of slicing police car performance. Start tomorrow using Rio Grande cracked gasoline. Ask your nearest independent Rio Grande dealer. It's our pleasure at this time to present once again Chief Bodie Wallman of the Oakland Police Department, who will speak to you from our studios at KSFO in San Francisco. Chief Wallman.
Good evening. Tonight, calling all cars, brings you another story from the files of the Oakland Police Department. A story of one more individual who thought that he could commit a crime and get away with it. That he was wrong, you will hear for yourself a little later. Right now, I would like to point out how vitally important it is to you, as citizens, to cooperate with your police force in every way. A great many people have the idea that a policeman is just a man with a badge who stands on the corner lying in wait to give you a ticket for parking. A man who has nothing better to do than to direct you to the curb when you violate some traffic law and give you a citation to appear in court. And you don't like it. You feel angry about it. But if you stop and reflect, didn't you feel just the same way about your instructor in school? Yet now that you're out of school, you realize your lessons were very valuable after all. The point that I'm trying to bring out tonight is the policeman is a person who dedicates his life to advise and protect you. When he stops, questions, or arrests you, it's because you're doing something that may endanger your own life or property or that of someone else's life, limb, or property. He is performing his sworn duty as a peace officer. So when you think of the police, think of them not as your enemies, but as your friends. In closing, may I say, good night, and a happy and prosperous new year to all.
September 1934. Patrolman O'Brien of the Oakland Police Department, detailed to the city park, walks a leisurely beat along the edge of a small pool filled with water lilies. To his way of thinking, this is the perfect day. Warm, clear, nothing to worry about, more than keeping people off the grass. But as he rounds the turn in the winding park pathway, he hears a strangely discordant note. The sound of a child sobbing. His curiosity aroused, Patrolman O'Brien decides to investigate.
Here now. What's all this crying about, young fella? Now, hold on a minute. This is no way for a big lad like you to be carrying on. Where's your mother? You don't know? Then you must be lost, is that it? Oh, well, now, come on now. You'll never find him this way. Now, I'll tell you what. You'll be after stopping that crying there, and I'll take you to look for your daddy. He'll probably be around here somewhere. Well, nevertheless, I think we can find him all right. That is, if you'll stop that crying and help me. Look, right. Hey, here, is that any way to ask? You say all right, and then to listen to you. I say, now, wait a minute, dear. You say he's watching on your back. Well, for the love of a note. Been down here with a safety friend. Now, hold still here, young fellow, till I get this off and see what it says.
My God, they put back.
Oh, he did, eh? Yeah. Ronald Tanner, 2326 Pellville Road. Is that your name? Ronald? And your daddy sent us on and went away. Well, I'll tell you what I'd better do, Ronald. I think we'll take a walk over here to the patrol box and phone the sergeant about this. Maybe he can help find your daddy. How's that? All right, good enough. And if the sergeant says so, maybe you'll get a ride in the police car. Now, how'd you like that? Yeah. All right, then. Dry your eyes and let's get going.
I will.
And as a result of the phone call, little Ronald does get a ride in a police car. Driving him to the address found on him, the radio car officers, finding no one home, decide to leave him in the yard, where his parents will find him upon the return home. Then, after reporting him to the station, they resume their patrol. Late the same afternoon, George Soderbergh, a reporter on the Oakland Tribune, and his photographer companion, Edward Rogers, hearing of the lost child incident, decide to go out and tell their road address and get a human interest yarn. But when they arrive there, they are met with a strange scene. Three small children huddled on the front porch, a girl of 11, a boy of about 6, and little Ronald, the reason for their being there. Looks like a reception committee, Ed.
Yeah, maybe the other two heard we were going to shoot pictures and hurried over.
Always a cynic, aren't you, son?
Why not?
Maybe you got something there at that. Come on, let's see what the huddle's about.
Okay.
What do you want?
Where are your parents?
I don't know.
Is this little Ronald?
Yes. How did you know his name?
Well, I'll tell you what. If I tell you how I knew not Ronald's name, can we shoot a picture of him?
What for?
For the papers.
Oh. Well, could you tell me where Mommy and your daddy are?
Oh, I'm afraid not. You see, that's what we came out here for. To see them and to get a story about Ronald having been lost in the park.
Lost in the park? When?
Today. He was found there with a note pinned on him with his name and address on it. That's how we came to know about him.
Well, but where's Mommy then? Or Daddy?
This is beginning to sound like a Chinese puzzle, George.
You said it. Look, little girl, who are you?
Francis Tanner. Ronald's my little brother.
And this little man is your brother, too?
Mm-hmm. That's Bobby.
Now, maybe you'd better tell us where you came from this afternoon.
The movie. Daddy came to school, and he gave me 50 cents and told me to take Bobby to his show. He said he didn't want us to come home for lunch either to get it at school.
So you went to a movie, and then what happened?
Well, we came home and found Ronald here in the yard all alone. He was crying.
Well, what was he crying about?
Daddy,
don't worry. Oh, he's
talked. What did you expect to find, Ronald?
I found a note on the door, but it didn't say where Mommy was.
Have you got it?
Yes, sir. It's still on the door there.
Now, wait a minute till I see what it says.
Gone for the day.
It's a great help. Gone for the day. Something we didn't know. Look, Ed, I think we'd better see if we can get into the house and take a look around. It's getting too cold outside for these kids anyway.
All right, with me, it's too cold for even a photographer.
Would you help us get in?
We'll do our best, young lady. You just try to keep Ronald under control, and Mr. Rogers and I will show you the fix of help stretching. Right, Edward?
Correct.
Now, the first thing to do is try the door. See if it's locked, you know.
Which I guess it is.
Right. Now, if I were a fireman, I might be tempted to use an axe on the door, but not being a fireman, I won't.
Look, George, what would you think about skipping the narrative and just sort of getting in the house, huh?
Oh, you don't like my little lecture.
No, I don't.
All right, I'm not so fond of it myself. Come on, let's look around by the back door. If it's locked, then I think we might be justified in removing it from the changes.
Yeah, sure, anything you say. Only will you stop sounding like a reporter trying to write a novel and get underway, I'm beginning to turn to ice.
Accordingly, the two men, accompanied by three small figures, make a complete journey around the house, buying windows, doors, anything that might afford a means of entrance. And finally, as a last resort, they decide to unhinge the back door.
That's done it. Set it down over here.
Now, let's see what we can do about making the place warm.
I know where the lights turn on, mister.
Good. Suppose you need to go in and turn them on.
Sure.
Well, that's awesome. I got a funny idea. These kids are on the raw end of a family walkout.
That's because you're a reporter. Probably find they took a drive and had a flat tire or something. Matter of fact, we'll probably get shot as burglars.
There they are. You can come in now.
Okay. Thanks. Come on, Ed.
Say, what in the name of all this?
Is this
the way your house always looks?
Oh, mister. I never saw everything all upset like this. My mama kept it neat always.
Well, look, you better stay back here with your brothers while we take a look in the front room.
Yeah.
I'll tell you later. Will you do that for me now?
All right.
Come on.
Sure.
Exactly.
Will you look at the furniture? All shelved around. Looks like an earthquake has struck.
Only, unless I miss my guess considerably, it wasn't an earthquake that did this.
So what are you driving at, George?
I got a funny feeling there's been a sweet battle of some sort in here. I've had that feeling ever since we stepped in the house. Something screwy in Denmark.
Think we ought to call the police?
Yeah. We better do that first thing and then take a good look around. And listen, Ed, we got to keep those kids out of here. I may be all wet, but in just in case I'm not.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Let's call the station.
Hurrying to the nearest phone, news photographer Rogers contacts Chief Wallman of the Oakland Police. Tells him of their discovery. And a short time later, Police Inspectors Evans and Summers arrive at the Telger Road address, are met by Soderberg and Rogers, who, while waiting, have uncovered some interesting things.
When we called the inspector, it was only on a hunch because of the furniture's condition, though. But since then, I've looked around, and now I'm sure something's wrong.
Oh.
Well, in the first place, there were about three places here on the floor where someone had tried to remove some kind of stains with a wet cloth. See?
Not a very thorough job of cleaning.
That's what I thought.
Probably whoever did it was in a hurry.
Yeah. Now, here's the baby that made me sure of everything.
Green plate. Just about right for a blackjack.
And if you look closely, I think you can see some dried blood on the end there.
It sure looks like it, all right.
Now, if you're satisfied that someone's been hurt around here, I'll tell you why. I think it's a murder.
Murder?
Yeah, a murder. Come here. Over here by the bed. You see what's behind it?
Sure. Small closet.
Unless my education's been sadly neglected. Closets aren't usually nailed shut, and this one is. The two nice new shiny nails.
Hey, did you push this bed up against the door, or was it that way?
It was just like it is now, shoved up tight against the closet.
Well, looks like the thing to do now is to look inside and see what's there.
Right. I got a claw hammer. Break it up so to have it ready when you arrive.
Good. Yeah. Let's have it.
Here you are.
Well, we better push that bed out of the way so we can get at it.
Yeah.
All right, I'll make a hole here. Push it up. Yeah, that's all right. Yeah. I can get at these nails now.
This is bad. The kids over the neighbor's side.
Yeah.
That's got it.
Now. A woman. You mean it was a woman. It hasn't been very long since she was killed either. Summit, you better get to the phone. Get an ambulance out. And tell Chief Wellman about it,
right?
Come on, Soderberg. You show me where those kids are. I want to talk to them.
Now,
After a brief talk with the Tanner girl, interrupted at intervals by Ronald's repeated message about his daddy going away, Evans and Soderbergh feel certain that the person responsible for the vicious slaying can be no other than the children's father, Lewis Tanner. Armed with this theory, Evans...
As far as I can see, Chief, everything fits perfectly. The kid Ronald being left in the park by his father, the other two kids being told not to come home and given 50 cents. Everything points to this Tanner as the one we want.
Yeah, sounds logical enough.
Now, even the time element works out right. If Tanner did it, he wouldn't want his kid around, so he makes certain that they stay at school for lunch and go to a movie after school in the afternoon. And Ronald, that's the youngest one, Ronald, he leaves out in the yard while he does the job inside. No, Ronald beats it.
All right, boys. You've done a good job of reconstruction. All we've got to do is to find Tanner. You got any ideas along that line?
Not yet, Chief.
And the first thing you'd better do is to check the files and see if he has a past record. Meanwhile, I'm going to have Inspector Goodnight check with every police girl for the same thing. If we don't get anything that way, we'll have to start from scratch, and that means plenty of work.
Thus, within 12 hours of the crime, every available bit of police machinery is set into motion. Every police identification bureau in the United States notified and set for a record. And in less than 36 hours, Chief Wallman begins to get results.
Oakland Police, regarding the bulletin number 25543, Lewis Tanner arrested here in November 1912 with stowaway, fined 5 pounds or 7 days. This is the only record we have. New Zealand Police. Oakland Police, find record files on one Lewis Tanner as follows. December 1912, arrested here in stowaway. Found 10 pounds for 4 weeks of hard labor. Took 4 weeks. The only record we have is under that name. Newcastle Police.
I found a record on Tanner, Chief Wallman. Pretty well cinched our theory, too.
Good. What is it?
On August 8th of this year, he tried to attack his wife with a butcher knife, and she had him thrown in jail here. Then she changed her mind. Got him out on bail, and he forfeited it. That was only last month.
So she gets him out on bail, and he turns around and murders her. Nice business.
We've got a good description of him on the booking slip.
Printed.
Him? Yes, sir?
Get Tanner's description from the files and have circulars printed and sent out to every possible point.
Yes, sir.
Also, you'd better teletype the description to every police station and ask the heads to issue it to every one of their men with orders to arrest and hold for us if located.
Of the wanted man and a thin lead to his habit, Chief Wallman issues precise orders to his assistant. Keeps the manhunt running smoothly, efficiently. Out to every police substation, to every sheriff's office in the country, goes a circular reading:
wanted for murder, Lewis Tanner, 51 years of age, medium build, black hair, blue eyes, weight approximately 150. If found, arrest, hold, and notify Oakland Police immediately.
And at the Oakland harbor front, Inspectors Evans and Summers with a squad of six men mingle with the crowd of sailors, laborers, stevedores. Keep an alert watch for the sign of their quarry, wife killer, Lewis Tanner.
About as much chance of spotting him in this mob as having him walk in and get himself up.
Yeah, especially when he knows we've been looking for him by now. He's probably disguised himself in some way.
Well, doesn't do any harm to look around. Might get lucky all of a sudden.
Yeah, it means just to be different, eh?
Something like that.
Hey, what did they do with the kid?
Took them over to the juvenile hall. I guess that's where they'll have to stay for a while. They're all too young to take care of themselves.
Tough start for a kid. One of them murdered, and their father put away for doing it. That is, providing we catch him.
Yeah.
Did we play how anyone could be such a fool to do anything like that?
People don't think about those things when they get the idea to murder someone.
Yeah, maybe they don't then. I bet they think about it plenty later on.
Well, didn't work to do any good to anybody to talk about it now. The kids will get the best of everything up there, and that's about the only thing anybody can do for them.
Yeah, I guess it's a pretty tough break to start out for just a thing.
Hey, listen, I've got a hunch we're wasting our time here. Let's leave the boys to come to the harbor, and you and I take a run up to that WPA camp. This little girl told us her father worked there.
Hey, listen, you don't think he'd be nuts enough to go back there, do you?
No. Only I'd like to see what the foreman of the place knows about it. Come on, let's get out of here.
For me?
You're the foreman of this camp. We are.
Well, you come to the right person, all right. My name's Harvey.
Inspector Evans, the Oakland Police, Mr. Harvey. This is Inspector Summers.
What's the matter? Something wrong? Priests don't usually pay calls on this camp.
Oh, we're just checking up on the man who works for you, Lewis Tanner. You know him?
Tanner? Sure. I know him all right.
Well, he isn't around here today, is he?
Nope. Matter of fact, he didn't show up at all this morning. Funny, too, on account of he's most of the time right here on the job. He must be sick or something.
Well, now, that's too bad. We sort of hope to have a little chat with him. But of course, if he's sick, well, I guess we'll have to make it another time.
He wasn't looking for him for any particular reason, was he?
No, just wanted to talk to him. But if he shows up, you might give us a call at the police station. Just say that Tanner's back to work, and we'll get the message.
Sure thing. I imagine he'll be back tomorrow or so.
Oh, fine. And incidentally, you don't have to mention the fact that we were here. Mm. That is, in case he does come back.
Yeah.
We want to surprise him. That right, Summers?
Huh? Oh, sure. Yeah, that's right. Surprise him. Well, I'll let you know when he comes back.
That's fine. Come on, Summers. Let's get back to town.
Well, come on. Come back sometime when I return the place.
Hey, what's the idea of playing games with that old bird, Evans? Telling him that we didn't want Tanner by any particular reason. Just an idea. Thought maybe if we kept him in the dark, he might possibly know where Tanner was and let us know.
Oh.
You can never tell when people are going to do funny things. However, I don't think anything will come of this trip. Come on, let's jump off.
Okay, what's stopping us?
Goes hour after hour, place after place, and no sign is found of the missing killer. Suspects are picked up by alert policemen in every city, questioned, turned loose again when they have proved their identity. Hours stretch on into the beginning of the second day. Each tiny lead is run down before being discarded. And as the second day gives way to night, Lewis Tanner is still at large. All that night and the following week, outbound ships are searched from stem to stern for stowaways, answering the description of the hunted man. Although many ships divulge a human cargo for inspection, Tanner is not among any of them. It is nearly 2 years later. In Oakland, the once indignant citizens have forgotten the brutal Tanner slaying. Newspapers have long since switched the focus of their attention to other things, to the news of the day. Only the Oakland police force still remember the crime and continue their efforts towards finding their man. Efforts will begin to seem futile as the months drag by. And in Seattle, Washington, Teddy Swanson, 13-year-old fisher youth, and a young companion trudge wearily along a windswept street, coat buttoned high against the bite of a bitter cold February night. Their thoughts run to the far-off summer more quickly. As they round the corner near Eddie's home, they pass one of the many straggling lines of human derelicts, waiting for a free handout in the red line. In the glare from an overhead street lamp, haggard faces reflect their owner's thoughts. Eyes stare ahead at nothing. Fascinated by the sight, Eddie stands each face in turn, his 13-year-old imagination painting multicolored pictures in his mind. Suddenly he stops, gazes for an instant at a face that seems vaguely familiar, eyes of playful. Failing to do so, he resumes his walking and a few blocks later reaches his own home. As he starts from the door, his memory suddenly flashes a message, galvanizes his body into instant action.
Yes, I'm now. What on earth are you looking so for? I've got an appointment to see about up in my room. Oh, now, where did I put him? Oh, I don't know. Oh, in here somewhere.
Now, remember what kind of situation was. What on earth are you up to? First, you run in like a madman, and now I find you trapped with those tearing those old magazines to pieces.
I'm in an awful hurry, Mom. I don't look through these facts. I think I saw a fellow in a police room.
Oh, nonsense. You're always thinking something of the sort. Now put those silly things away and get ready for dinner.
Here, I got it. I got the right one, Mom.
Well, you don't have to get so excited about it.
I'll be back later, Mom. Gotta go now.
But your dinner is almost ready. You can.
Well, I can't help it. I gotta get to the police station fast. Go on.
And in less than 5 minutes, at the police station...
Hurry up. I got a man you're looking for.
Wait a minute. Take it easy, son. You'll bust if you aren't careful.
Yeah, I know, but this fella's standing in a bread line. And if you don't hurry and get there fast, you'll be gone again.
Let me see that picture you got there.
Here you are. I had him in the detective magazine.
Wanted for murder. You sure this is the man you saw?
Of course I am. I wouldn't forget a face that easy.
All right, son. Show me the man in the bread line. I'll take a chance on you being right.
Oh, don't worry, sir. I'm right. You see, I'm a detective, too.
Oh.
Only not like you. I haven't got a bag.
Well, if this is the right man, we'll see what we can do about that. Come on, let's go.
Following Eddie Swanson, amateur flute, Captain Yoder finds himself running through the wind-swept streets, wondering if perhaps he isn't the victim of a youthful prank. But at last, they reach the bread line, and after a moment's hesitation, Eddie points a thin finger at one man, then points back to the picture.
You see?
Yeah, I see all right.
Then what are you on?
Oh, far from it, son. You hit it right on the nose. Listen to me carefully. I want you to stay right here in the shadow. I walk up to this man, watch what happens. And if anything goes wrong, you speed it back as fast as your legs will carry him to the station and tell the sergeant. Understand?
Yes, sir. You think he might try to get away?
Well, I think there's a very good chance of it. So you stay over here. Now, those are orders, understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and here goes. Your hands.
What?
You heard me. Stick out your hands and make it happen.
Hey, wait a minute, mister. I guess you're a cop from the looks of you, but you haven't got anything on me. There's nothing to make me stick my hands.
Listen, Tanner. I'm telling you once more to stick out your hands and be quiet. And this is the last time I'm going to.
Oh, please. What have I got to worry about? It?
Well, you can't frame anything on me.
I don't have to. You've already framed yourself.
Now, you're going to walk back to the station quietly with me, or do I have to drag you?
Suit yourself.
I'll walk.
Good. That's the first smart thing you've done yet. Come on.
But once back in Captain York's office, the man denies all knowledge of the crime, denies his name, his manner, denies him everything. And Captain York continues to throw questions at him.
Well, if your name isn't Tanner, if you're not from Oakland, then who are you?
That doesn't make any difference. My name's not Tanner.
How do you explain this picture of you in the detective magazine?
I don't.
How do you explain this bulletin I found in our files with a description of you in it marked wanted for murder?
That's not me.
How long do you think you can get away with this bluff, Tanner?
I'm not bluffing.
Then what's your name and where do you live?
I don't know. I can't think with all these questions.
You don't have to think to tell me.
I don't.
You don't. If you're lying.
I don't.
You don't what?
I don't remember.
Your name is Tanner, isn't it?
Yes. No, it's not Tanner. Lewis Tanner.
And you murdered your wife and left your three kids deserted in Oakland, didn't you?
Yes, yes, I did.
I
can't stand any more questions. I don't want a piece of pipe. I'm sorry I couldn't help it. I had to kill him.
Lewis Tanner was returned to Oakland, where he signed a full confession of the brutal crime. On April 22nd, 1936, he was convicted of murder by a jury of seven men and women. 2 weeks later, Judge Frank M. Ogden of Alameda County sentenced him to the death penalty. An appeal to the California Supreme Court was denied in October, sealing the death warrant for Lewis Tanner, murderer. And Eddie Swanson, the 13-year-old boy responsible for the arrest, was awarded the sum of $100 for his alertness. So ends the case of Oakland's heinous murder. No matter what the age or make of your motor car, it deserves efficient lubrication. Resolve to give it the finest you can buy during 1937. Resolve to use only Sinclair motor oils and greases. Go to your nearest independent Rio Grande dealer and ask for Sinclair Pennsylvania or Sinclair Opaline, two of the most completely de-waxed, de-jellied motor oils you can buy. And if you haven't tried Rio Grande cracked gasoline, you have a pleasant surprise in store for you. This quicker starting, faster accelerating, greater mileage gasoline will give you a new conception of performance, police car performance. That flashing type of performance the police cars, fire engines, and ambulances of Los Angeles, Oakland, and many, many other cities and counties get in their emergency equipment. Important changes in Calling All Cars radio schedules are explained in Calling All Cars News. Get a free copy tomorrow from your independent Rio Grande dealer.
Attention all cars. Cancellation broadcast 162. Sergeant man wanted for murder. Back to the stage now in custody. That's all.
Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company, wishing you.